Today, we're going to unpack one of the most powerful and, honestly, kind of counterintuitive ideas in all of economics. It's the hidden logic that explains why countries trade and how, in this massive global game, it's actually possible for everyone to win. Let's dive in. So it all kicks off with this puzzle. Just imagine there's a superstar country out there. I mean, it's more productive and can make everything better and faster than its neighbors. Now, common sense would tell you they shouldn't bother trading with a less efficient partner, right? Well, as we're about to see, that common sense is totally, completely wrong. To figure this out, we're going to simplify the entire global economy down to this one little table. We've got two economies, A and B, and they only make two things, butter and milk. So in economy A, one worker can produce 5 tons of butter or 25 tons of milk. Meanwhile, over in economy B, a worker can make 12 tons of butter or 24 tons of milk. Okay, so the first way to look at this is the most straightforward. We just ask a simple question. Who is flat out better at making each thing? This is what economists call absolute advantage. You know, to put it simply, absolute advantage just means you're the most productive. It's a straight up comparison. If you and I are both baking cookies and you can bake way more cookies in an hour than I can, you've got the absolute advantage. Easy enough, right?
So looking at our numbers, who's the champ? Well, for butter, economy B is the clear winner, churning out 12 tons to A's 5. So that's an absolute advantage for B. For milk, it's super close, but economy A just barely edges out B, 25 tons to 24. So the absolute advantage in milk goes to A. Case closed, right? B makes butter, A makes milk.
And you know, this is where a lot of people stop. It just seems obvious. But if that were the whole story, honestly, the global economy would be a lot less interesting. We've got to dig deeper.
And this brings us to the real magic trick, the heart of it all, comparative advantage. The key to unlocking this whole thing is to stop asking who is best and start asking a much, much smarter question, who gives up the least?
Now, to find that comparative advantage, we first have to understand its secret ingredient, which is opportunity cost. See, every choice you make has a hidden cost. It's the value of the road not taken. If a worker in economy A spends all day making butter, they are actively choosing not to make milk. And that lost milk, that is the true cost of their butter.
Okay, so let's run the numbers. For economy A, making those 5 tons of butter means they don't make 25 tons of milk. So if we just divide 25 by 5, we see the real cost of 1 ton of butter is 5 tons of milk. Now let's look at economy B. To make 12 tons of butter, they give up 24 tons of milk. Divide 24 by 12, and their cost for 1 ton of butter is only 2 tons of milk.
And this is the light bulb moment. Economy B isn't just better at making butter, it's also way more efficient. It only gives up 2 tons of milk to get a ton of butter, while economy A has to give up a staggering 5 tons.
And that right there is the entire definition of comparative advantage. It has nothing to do with being the best in absolute terms. It's all about being the most efficient, the one who has the lowest opportunity cost.
So, let's put it all together. We just saw that economy B has the comparative advantage in butter. And if you were to run the numbers for milk, you'd find that economy A has the lower opportunity cost there. So what does this mean? For maximum efficiency, each of them should specialize. B should go all in on butter, and A should go all in on milk.
And here's the really cool thing, like a mathematical law of trade. It's actually impossible for one country to have a comparative advantage in everything. It just can't happen. Even a nation that isn't as productive will always have a lower opportunity cost. They'll be the least bad, if you will, at making something.
Okay, so what's the point of all this math? How does figuring this out actually make anyone better off? Well, this is where specialization and trade come together to create something that feels, well, it feels kind of like magic.
So here's how it plays out. Economy A goes all in, producing only milk. Economy B goes all in, producing only butter. They each make a ton of their specialized product, and then they trade. And the result is incredible. Citizens in both countries can now consume more milk and more butter than they ever could have on their own. And that's the key takeaway here. Trade doesn't change what a country can make, but it radically expands what its people can have.
All right, theory is one thing, but let's make sure this has really clicked. I'm going to throw a new scenario at you, a little pop quiz. Let's see if you can spot the comparative advantage on your own.
Here's our new setup. This time, it's oranges and pears. But notice something interesting here. For oranges, both economies are equally productive. A worker in either place can produce exactly half a ton of oranges. But when it comes to pears, economy A is way, way ahead.
So, here's the question. I'm going to show you the options on the next slide. but I really want you to pause and try to work it out. Calculate that opportunity cost. Okay, here are your choices. A, B, C, or D. Take a second, run the numbers, and just remember the key question. To make 1 ton of oranges, who has to give up the fewest pears?
All right, you got your answer? Let's walk through it together. For economy A to produce 1 ton of oranges, they have to give up a whopping 12 tons of pears. Now let's look at economy B. For them to produce that same ton of oranges, they only have to give up 2 tons of pears.
And there you have it. Economy B's opportunity cost is so much lower, just 2 pairs versus 12, and that gives it the comparative advantage. So the correct answer is D. Even though their absolute productivity in oranges was identical, their efficiency underneath was worlds apart.
And that really is the main lesson for today. International trade isn't driven by who's the absolute best at something. It's driven by who is relatively better, who is the most efficient producer when you measure what they have to sacrifice. This is the simple, powerful logic that stitches our entire global economy together.
So I'll leave you with this thought. This logic doesn't just apply to countries and products. You live it every single day. I mean, the time you're spending right now listening to this is time you can't spend doing something else. That's an opportunity cost. So what are the hidden trade-offs shaping your life? Once you start looking for them, you'll see them everywhere.